Dear Miss Kyota, dear Miss Holtgrün, dear Mr. Imafuku, and of course, dear Hubertus Barth, thank you very much for inviting me to this very important session, which I am happy to experience in a new normal with regards to the format we are having here. And I'm happy that this is working out so well. Before I start talking about the German automotive industry and the future trends we are facing right now, let me say a few words with regards to our federation. Our federation is 119 years old, and it comprises not only the large OEMs which produce in Germany, brand names which everybody knows, but also over 600 suppliers, large and small, which together form the ecosystem of automotive production in Germany. Here you see the logos. I hope it's complete. It shows how complex interaction is and how complex our industry is with regards to all kinds of steps in the supply chain. You see many brand names here which also belong to other branches of industry like BASF from the chemical industry, which also shows how strongly aligned we are with our with neighboring branches like the chemical industry, like the machinery industry, like the metalworking industry. And so not only, and Hubertus Barth has rightly pointed this out, is the German automotive industry one of the locomotives of growth and innovation in Germany, but it's also strongly intertwined with neighboring branches very much. And this, in times of crisis, means two things. It means a specific challenge, because any effect the crisis does have, had, and will have on the automotive industry will be strongly felt through the economy as a whole. Hubertus Barth has pointed this out, but it also gives social responsibility, because with over 800,000 direct employees and many more indirect employees, it is very important to give work to our associates and to really keep them producing. And we try to do this coming out of the crisis with the highest standards with regard to health and safety and with regard to protecting our employees from COVID. This is one of the prerequisites that slowly but certainly we try to come out of the deep valley we have seen in late spring with regards to production, but also, of course, with regards to sales. Now, coming up to the mega trends which our branch has to work with, of course, we see alternative power coming up. Professor Schwarze has elaborated already on the importance of decarbonizing our economy as a whole and, of course, of decarbonizing transport. And we as an industry have strongly committed to fully decarbonizing transport until 2050. Then we have automation, we have connectivity, and we have new services and new business models, which will, of course, strongly transform the industry. However, nobody really knows how it will transform the industry. Now, there's lots of talk on the effects on the crisis might have on mobility patterns. Of course, we see a strong diminution of the use of public transport. However, we do not see an equivalent ramping up of sales or an equivalent growth of transport by individual mobility. So from our point of view, it's far too early. It's far too early to say whether this will be a long-standing effect or whether this is only a short-term effect, and the sooner the better we will be able to manage the crisis, then things will readapt and readjust. And we know that our colleagues from public transport but do a lot to protect people also in public transport, and we are not the ones who think that what is bad for public transport is good for the automotive industry. On the contrary, we have to work closely together, particularly in urban contexts, in order to give our customers and to give the people at large a premium experience with regards to their individual mobility. Now, if we see at some positive scenarios or trends which really push the transformation, it's oil cost, it's decarbonization I've been talking about, it's of course the development of technology, sensor technology, artificial intelligence, connectivity as a whole, which really drive the transformation. And then it comes, of course, to the engine technologies, combustion engine efficiency. There's still some potential in there, but in the middle. In the midterm perspective, of course, the potential will hit the limits, and then we have all the technologies, be it fuel cell, be it electric mobility, be it direct use of hydrogen, which will greatly transform and which will enable the decarbonization of mobility in the long term. As costs come down, as battery energy density comes up, and as market penetration, particularly with regards to new energy vehicles, comes up, we have said in the National Platform for the Transformation of Mobility, of which I'm happy to be a member, that in 2030 we will see 7 to 10 million electrified vehicles on the roads in Germany alone. 7 to 10 million vehicles, which transforms into somewhere around 40% new registrations electric vehicles, be it battery electric or plug-in hybrids. Of course, we have population growth, which is particularly relevant for the cities, because not only is the population growing in many parts of the world, but also urbanization is even getting faster and faster and transforming the needs of mobility again. On the other hand, it's the regulatory pressure and the public pressure, not only in Germany and Europe, but also worldwide, which forces us to decarbonize strongly. We have put on this slide the requirements the EU has put upon us with regards to carbon dioxide till 2030 and what this means with regards to infrastructure and energy consumption. So around 50% new car registration, zero and low emission vehicles, 1 million charging points in 2030, huge growth in energy consumption, and of course, a huge growth in battery cell demand, and this energy, of course, should be green energy after all. How do we cope with this challenge? You see a huge growth in R&D spending with regards to personnel, but also with regards to investments. And on the right side, you see the automotive industry is the one industry in Germany with the largest share with R&D spending in Germany after all. This is not always reflected in public discussions when we are seen sometimes as old-fashioned or sleepy. Finally, I think the numbers speak their own language. In July, we have for the first time seen over 10% registrations of overall registrations with a battery and plug-in hybrid vehicles. So things are moving fast here, and of course, economic programs and support programs by governments, not only in Germany but also many other EU member states, do help in this regard. So we see a large growth in demand here. Here we have the overall international comparison. Of course, you see that China is very strong, EU is strong, Norway is very strong. These are absolute numbers. If you see the models which we have on the market now or which we expect until end of this year, you see that many more electric vehicles, be it plug-in, be it battery electric vehicles, will be available and are available from our members right now on the near future. So the offensive for electrification really is on the road. This is true also internationally. If you see the relative market share of German OEMs worldwide, more or less we are quite confident that German electrified cars will be successful worldwide. However, if we talk of electrified vehicles, we do not only talk of new products and everything else stays the same, but we have to talk of the whole ecosystem. This is technology, this is also training and qualification if we look at production, but if we also look at our trading partners, we have to look at urban planning and intermodality, because electrified mobility does of course affect urban planning when it comes to charging infrastructure, but also when it comes on the needs to intermodality. And of course, it is a huge challenge for the production of renewable energies worldwide, because this is what we finally need. So the overall context is much more complicated than just shifting production. And this is where we really also have to look on how to, for example, make electromobility possible in densely populated quarters, like inner city quarters, how to make it possible possible in the rural areas where long ranges are still driven. I mean, there are people in Germany who drive over 100 kilometers every day to their workplace. How can we make electric mobility fit also to these mobility demands? So far, on electric mobility, I will be only very short and very brief on electronics and digitization. Electronics and digitization is nothing new. We have seen comfort and entertainment systems also in the 80s. We have seen safety systems in the 90s. We have seen navigation starting in the 2000s. So nothing new here. What we really see now in the digital age is we have a wholly new ecosystem of products and services where a car is only a part of the overall ecosystem and does not stay as the product alone. So if you yesterday have bought a car and that's it, you kept your car maybe 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, now you buy a car and you buy an ecosystem of services, most of them based on the internet in the future. This translates into many, many, many different and complex questions when it comes to safety, when it comes to navigation systems, but also when it comes to interaction with the World Wide Web in general. If all this is translated into what happens to mobility in the narrower sense, of course, we have at least three aspects which we have to look at when talking about autonomous driving. It's, of course, the positive effects on emission and the environment. It's but also the positive effect on safety. From our point of view, Vision Zero is really a vision which we can positively attain if we take automated and autonomous driving seriously. And last but not least, digitization and connectivity strengthens comfort, not only comfort because it's more comfortable to stay in your car, this is one thing, but also the comfort of the overall experience of transport and of mobility. So also switching transport modes seamlessly is part of the overall comfort which we see here. These are just a few numbers with regards to safety. Where we see a very strong decline in fatal accidents, but also in overall accidents, which will keep stronger when we come to higher levels of automation. Because looking at the step-by-step development, now we talk of assistance system on highway systems, but in urban and in rural contexts, we will see a very strong development in the next couple of years, not only when it comes to automated vehicles, which may not be individual cars in the first place in the urban sector, but also in the rural sector. Mobility will greatly change when we see automated and in the midterm perspective and long-term perspective, fully autonomous vehicles, which might not necessarily be individual vehicles. This is very interesting because autonomous driving is not so very easy. Yeah? You have very ambiguous driving situations in any car. Here are just some of them. Where software and hardware have to cope with, and this is why the fusion of sensors, the use of artificial intelligence is so very important with regards to what we really intend to do. This is what we are working upon in a high-speed scale, because only if we work on infrastructure systems, on standardization systems, on network coverage, data availability, and of course public acceptance, which is also a very important element here, then we can be successful with regards to the changes and the challenges, the transformation of mobility towards higher levels of automation and finally to automated driving might entail. So this only as a very brief introduction. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm happy to discuss this and other issues you might have with you later in the session. Thank you.